Well, welcome to the show.
This is our view from the bench.
Well, welcome to the show. I'm Brendan, sign organizer for the UFC Ring Girls.
And I'm Corey, shoe cleaner for the Tap Dance Club, and happy Thursday.
Happy Thursday. It's early this week, but
yeah,
I love it.
Got Thursday Night Football to talk about, man. That's going to be yes. Our main thing today.
Main thing. Love football. However, breaking news. Breaking news.
Dude.
Crazy stuff happened yesterday, and it wasn't in football. NBA is dropping bombs, Waj bombs. Damian Lillard officially traded to the Milwaukee Bucks. What did you think when you just first saw the headline?
Well, it was crazy because I was like up already and like just kind of doing my thing for the day because I didn't have to work till later yesterday working a game. But when I saw it, I was like, whoa, like that's not where I thought he was going to end up. Everybody kept saying obviously he wanted to go to Miami. There was rumors of Toronto being possibly a thing, but I definitely didn't expect the Bucks, but they gave up. I mean, they gave up a lot, but at the same time, like it's a three-team deal, so there's a lot of things involved. But Portland did really good in the deal, I think, in the long run for themselves.
I agree too. I think that them not only the draft picks too, but the players that they acquired are good. I know there's rumors that Jrue Holiday may not stay, but that's still really good capital to get back in a trade. So let's look at what actually kind of went down in all of it. We have it up on the screen here for the YouTube audience. For those of you listening on the podcast, go check it out. Just search Our View from the Bench. And you can see our faces and see all the stuff that we make for you. That way you don't have to try to like write it down, especially when it comes to trades like this.
Yeah, for real. This is complicated.
The biggest one, obviously, we'll just get that one out of the way, is Damian Lillard is going to Milwaukee. So Milwaukee gets out of this deal. They get Damian Lillard. The Suns acquire Yusuf Nurkic from Portland. Grayson Allen, Nasir Little, and Keon Johnson. It's a three-team trade. Suns are involved. What do the Blazers get, man?
DeAndre Ayton is the main piece they're getting back, starting at center. As you mentioned, they get Jrue Holiday, who we'll go into in a second. They get Tumani Kamara. They get Milwaukee's 2029 first-round pick for sure, and then they have first-round swaps with them in 28 and 2030. So, again, yeah. In the long run, the Blazers are getting some pieces now, but they're also getting pieces down the line.
Which is really important because you're losing – I mean, you have a very young team. You're losing a veteran, and it's great that they got back exactly what they did. I think it was very smart what they did. I think it was great that they were patient. They didn't cave in. I actually had seen something that came across today that said initially, actually – once Damian Lillard had seen that a trade with the Heat wasn't really going to be working out, he kind of rescinded his trade request. General manager didn't really take lightly to that. He says, you can't go back now.
Yeah,
so
it's too late.
He went on and he found what he needed. And I think he honestly did everything right. He was patient about it. He got back a lot of stuff. And he sent Damian Lillard, maybe not to his preferred destination, but he sent him to a really, really good destination. Yeah. It may not be South Beach, so maybe the location is not as good because it's in Milwaukee. But basketball-wise, I mean, he's on a championship-contending team, no?
Yeah. No, absolutely. Yeah, you can't do it. They did everything right, and you're right. I heard about that report about he said, at that point, we already drafted Scoot for him to take your position. Like, we don't want to go into training camp and media day with all those questions of, are you happy that they got your replacement now on the bench behind you, or asking Scoot, like, are you here and happy to be having to, you know, fight for a job with Damian Lillard and try to take over his, like, era? So that's right. Like, if you're Portland, you don't want that distraction. And again, once you ask for the trade and it's become this public, like the NBA's had to like step in and say, hey, stop talking about it. There's no going back. It's too late. If you would have been more quiet about it and it would have never leaked out or became this big old ordeal, maybe you could then maybe, all right, we'll rescind and we'll try to reevaluate what we can do. But like you said, they didn't screw him over. They got him to a good place as far as basketball is concerned. He's got an opportunity to play and win a title right now.
And exactly.
That's probably a year or two. They get something out of it, again, short-term and long-term. And then depending on what they get Jrue Holiday for, they'll probably get a first-rounder, I would think, at least, and then a player or two for Jrue Holiday. So in the long run, They're going to end up with another couple players. So I think Portland wins.
Yep.
I mean, the Suns also winning in a way, though, if you think about it. Like, they
annoyingly, yeah, to be honest. Yeah,
they got some depth on their roster. With, I mean, Grayson Allen's annoying, but he's a good player. Nasir Little, Keon Johnson are a little less known, but they're actually some decent guys. And Nurkic isn't great anymore because he's older. But I heard this little wrinkle that when Nurkic was first in the NBA, he was on the Nuggets. Him and Jokic were there at the same time.
Okay.
And they had, and the Nuggets had to decide, okay, which big man are we going with? Because they basically are the same thing at the moment, not who they are now.
Yeah, obviously not now. Yeah.
Yeah. So they traded Nurkic to Portland instead and kept Jokic, which that worked out for them very well.
Very well.
No. But I guess they're very close and know each other really well and practice against each other. So I think this might be one of those things that Nurkic isn't going to be great every game, but maybe just to have as a body to go up against Jokic and maybe know him a little more and how to, like, kind of get into him defensively. Like, remember how Dwight Howard didn't play a lot in that series, but he definitely went out there and affected Jokic by being more physical and kind of beating him up. I'm thinking they're kind of, their thought process is maybe Nurkic, since he knows him so well, will be able to, like, make it a little harder for him. He's not going to stop him. Nobody's going to stop him.
Nobody can.
But at least make it harder and a little more complicated.
Not even just him. Yes, him. But them being obviously in the West, they also have other big men that they have to contend with too.
Yeah.
So Jokic is their main competitor because that's obviously who really knocked them out last year. They need some another body to throw at them because the gentleman they traded away, Mr. Ayton, he was no match, obviously. You remember that replay that's famous? I bring it up every single time we talk about DeAndre Ayton. There's a point where he goes up for something like a lay, and he gets like kind of pushed a little bit, not like pushed, but just like bumped out of the way.
Yeah,
and he ends like up on the side. Yeah, ends up on the baseline. And he's standing out of bounds, ball still live. And meanwhile, KD, Kevin Durant, and Jokic are battling for the rebound.
Like,
and DeAndre Ayton is standing there. Yeah, they're going like 2-1, 2-3, and DeAndre Ayton is standing there watching the entire thing, doing exactly what you and I are doing, but getting paid $33 million to do it.
Yeah.
It was crazy. So I think they're happy to be rid of him.
Yeah.
And another thing. So, yeah, exactly. So.
It sucks, too, because I, as a U of A basketball fan, Ayton obviously was there for a year, and he did a lot of good things there. So I'm always kind of like rooting for those guys, but he just didn't fit in Phoenix, and they didn't want him back there anyway. I mean, he signed a restricted free agency contract with Indy last summer and then only came back because they matched it. They didn't want to be there. So now that the year is up, they decided to trade him wherever they wanted to, and this is where he ends up, which if you're Ayton, you kind of win. Like, you got Scoot Henderson, Anfernee Simons. Like, it's just them running pick and roll with you and no really expectations of competing and playing in the playoffs even. They're probably just going to be in the bottom, maybe back in the top part of the lottery next year and getting another pick to continue with all these young guys that they're now doing in Portland.
Which could do two things for him. One, it could actually make him hungry maybe for some competitive basketball because he's just been like coasting by while Devin Booker, Chris Paul, and the such carry them. And then Kevin Durant, Devin Booker, and Chris Paul carry them. So not only will it give him that, but it'll also give him time to develop something more in his game. I don't know what it is, but he needs an improvement in a lot of it. I would say he's good at rebounding because he gets them in the double digits, but that's honestly, I feel, just because he's tall. I don't feel that there's a lot of effort to be put in it because I think he'd be in the 20s. He'd be like that old school Kevin Love, like on the Timberwolves. Like that kind of is the amount of rebound if he put effort. He's tall and athletic. I just don't understand it, but I think the Suns are happy to be rid of him. And if the doesn't really work out in Portland, then they can figure out, I think there's only 3 years left on his contract. They'll try it out for a year or two, and if not, maybe dump him to somebody or let him walk.
Somebody will always be like, oh, if we take him in here, we can change him. There's always one of those GMs somewhere. Like, everybody said the Russell Westbrook contract was not going to be tradable, and it was traded twice. Like, he got to Washington, then he came to the Lakers, and then they traded. Like, it's a possibility to trade any contract, and Ayton's is not that bad. And like you said, he's a 7-footer. Even when he's not trying, he's probably getting 8 to 10 rebounds just being out there as a person. Like, hands up in the air, got one. Like, it's not that hard. You know what I mean? So,
agree.
I don't know. Just Phoenix got rid of what they obviously didn't need in the locker room. But now it's crazy. I think I sent you that thing that Devin Booker's the only guy left from the 2021 NBA Finals that the Suns played in just a few years ago, which is
just really weird to hear about because that's not that long ago. If it was like, oh, Devin Booker's the last one from the 2017 team, you're like, oh, okay. Well, I mean, it's been freaking 6 years.
Yeah.
I assume some people would move on, retire, et cetera. But no, that was just 2 years ago. They did lose to these Bucks.
Yes, they did. Which, man. And did you see the Lillard jerseys already up in the store in Milwaukee? Selling them like crazy off the shelves, dude.
Of course. Why not? Dame's cool, man. I like Dame. So I think it's good. I think I'm happy to honestly see him in a completely other team. And like you said, I think I'm happy to see him. It's done early. Not yeah. too early because some stuff has already started, but at least they get some sort of preseason together. Kind of see yeah. how they can make it mesh.
Yeah, absolutely. They'll have an opportunity to at least have some kind of camp together.
Yeah. Someone who may not actually stay in their camp, though, as we referred to earlier, is Jrue Holiday. Like you said, one of the pieces that they might be able to flip is Jrue for a first-round pick, maybe, and maybe another player or two. Obviously, a couple of players because salaries have to match, unless other teams get involved, of course. $36 million, $37 million, actually, though, this year. And he's got another year as well. I think it's a player option.
Yeah.
But there was a post that ESPN, I think it was, posted, and they had like nine teams that they thought would be a good fit for Jrue Holiday. I kind of reviewed them. I'm not saying I'm more of an expert than ESPN, but a lot of them kind of didn't make sense to me, but some of them did. So we got bored and we decided to cook up a couple of trades to see like where Jrue might be able to move to. So we picked three that we think would be the most likely, at least by team's willingness to trade and real feasibility. Obviously we use the NBA trade machine to ensure that everything was as it would. Leave. And the first one,
get it done right.
And the first one is, of course, the place who just missed out on him, Miami. Do you see this happening?
I mean, it makes the most sense that they're going to be the first in line because they missed out on Dame Lillard, and they've been talking to Portland this whole time. So there's obviously a connection there of like trying to get a deal done, just not ultimately finishing that one. Mm-hmm. So the opportunity to get it, but I mean, Tyler Herro and Duncan Robinson are good, but if you're Portland, I feel like you're going to want more. There's got to be a draft pick involved probably as well, right? They're not going to just get a couple players. They're going to want capital more than – and then don't be shocked if they end up turning one of those guys around if that's the case.
The hard part is that when I was looking through the rosters, there's nobody on the Heat. I mean, there's people that I feel like the Portland would ask for, but – the only other person besides like Bam and Jimmy, you're starting to get into like maybe Kyle Lowry.
Yeah.
I guess you could trade them as a swap, but I don't really know if that's necessarily improving the team. I mean, I think it is because I think Jrue is a little bit better, well, at least defensively. Kyle Lowry is maybe even slightly better offensively, but I just felt like that was a weird wash. So I know that Duncan Robinson and I know that Tyler Herro for sure was in trade talks for Dame. So I just kind of put through those in here. And yeah. Money-wise, it kind of works.
No, absolutely. I'm just thinking, too, now that you mentioned, I'm like, Kyle Lowry, do you think they could somehow include him because Portland could then just buy him out and still get a draft pick or something for Holiday, essentially?
Maybe.
Because I'm just worried, Portland, dude. And you're trying
they weren't talking. Like, they weren't willing to throw Lowry in with Dame. So I'm wondering why they had that hesitation, you know?
That's true. That's a good point.
So that's the only reason why when we cooked them up, we didn't really. I see your point, but I was kind of, I don't know. I just went with names that I heard. I was like, well, the money matches and the names that I heard are there. So why not?
Yeah, no, for sure. I'm just trying to think of other ways they can kind of alter or make other deals to get.
Because Caleb Martin might be one. $8 million.
That's true. Oh, yeah. If Portland's trying not to really making up much contracts, that's not going to help.
That's not making much ground up. And other than that, you're looking at Bam and Jimmy, and those are the two I feel like are also untouchable. So
yeah,
absolutely. It'd be a weird one, but again, this is one that we thought would be, like Corey said, the first one in line.
Yep.
Next, though, someone that I know wants to be rid of a guard and would love to replace them.
Yeah.
Mr. Joel Embiid.
Yeah, could you imagine they just flop him and then Harden gets stuck in Portland by himself with all these young kids? Oh, he would hate it, right? That would just be the worst. But if you're Holiday, I believe he played in Philly before and was drafted there and won Rookie of the Year back in the day. So he would love to go. He would be the perfect fit along with Embiid and Tobias Harris and everything they else.
Tyrese Maxey.
Yeah, that would just be like the perfect fit. So if you're Philly, you have to be calling Portland, throw in a draft pick if you have to get it, and then let Portland figure out how to get Harden out of there, which once Harden's there,
buy him out.
If he still wants to get somewhere else, Portland be happy to trade him because they'll probably get a first-round pick out of that as well and just continue to get all this capital for having this young team to continue to build.
Why not? So here we just have, like he said, a straight shot. Why not do it? I thought that was interesting.
They're making almost the same amount of money. That's crazy. It's very.
But good. I know that you were talking about James Harden. What were you thinking? Because if this doesn't work, like, didn't you say that? What were you telling me earlier about?
Well, okay, so there was obviously there's rumors that Harden wants to be on the Clippers, so maybe this is the opportunity,
right? That's what, yeah, duh,
to add them in as a third team in this trade. Because if you're Portland, even if you're in the division with the Clippers, you're not really caring. You're not competing with them right now, or the Lakers, or anybody else. So you're just trying to get as much as you can. But the problem is the Clippers don't have very many first round picks because they gave up a lot of them to get Paul George. So if you can include Philly, maybe Philly can get the first round pick for you to Portland. And then you somehow get Harden and you give up, like, probably, I would think, Markieff Morris, maybe Robert Covington, or who's the other one I'm thinking of?
Norman Powell.
Yeah, Norman Powell. If I'm Portland, if you're Portland, you can't get Zubac because you already have Ayton. Never mind. I'm trying to get Zubac out of the Clippers. I don't know what that is about me.
I don't know either. Yeah. Every time we talk about them, I don't care. Let me stop you there, though, because that was the other thing that I think. So. Marcus Morris, just like he had said. Norman Powell, just like he had said.
Okay.
And unfortunately, as much as I wouldn't want this to happen, because Jrue Holiday is way better than James Harden and would actually help them win a championship. Yeah. And I want them to get James Harden because I don't want them to get anywhere close to one.
Yes, facts.
This is a way that they can acquire a guard, a very, very high caliber starting guard for a couple pieces.
Yep. But like he said, the problem is if Portland's going to want draft picks, the Clippers don't have any. So I think that's why there's no way there's going to be a straight shot for Holiday to get there. And I don't know if there's a third team that the Clippers could get involved with Portland and not, because James Harden has to get out of Philly. There's no way he's going to show up. That's going to be the most awkward thing. So you got to get him out of there and include them in this deal. And then Holiday's going to have to just end up in Philly. If you're the Clippers, you got to take Harden. Oh, if you can get anything, because if I just don't understand how Philly still has him there. How is this still possible?
Daryl Morey is a tough son of a gun. He's not giving up unless he gets exactly what he wants, and I feel like that's kind of what it's just going to be. So James Harden better sit tight.
Oh,
we'll see what he might have to do.
You know, another place I would thought about, we didn't do a trade for or anything, but I was thinking about would be interesting for him to ultimately end there would be Chicago for Jrue Holiday, because now that Lonzo Ball's out, he could just step in at the starting in the starting rotation. You'd have Zach LaVine, DeMar DeRozan, Alex Caruso, Nikola Vucevic, Otto Porter Jr., Andre Drummond, Derrick Jones Jr. Like, that's a pretty interesting team in the Eastern Conference. I feel like they could be in the top six, like a 6 or 5 seed possibly. They're not going to win necessarily the Central, but they could be in the hunt for a playoff spot.
So who do you think they have to give up, though? Because, like, what's the big piece? Are you saying, I know you're always involving a third team, but if you had to pick straight up, are they taking Alonzo off their hands? They're not trading Zach LaVine or DeMar DeRozan, are they?
No, they're not trading those guys, and they're not going to give up Lonzo because Lonzo's already been, you know, designated out for the year, which is why they have the extra cap space to get, like, a free agent.
If they're not trading any of those players, they either have to wait until December or they need to involve a third team, because the highest salary that they have that's tradable besides any of those players, again, they have Vucevic, but he's not tradable until January, basically. It's the end of December. That's $18.5 million. Kobe White, same thing. That's $11 million. But the only other ones are 9.8 and 9.4, which is Alex Caruso and PJ Williams.
Okay,
Patrick Williams.
I would do Patrick Williams and Kobe White included in that for sure if I'm getting Jrue Holiday.
Yeah, I know that's not tradable, but basically that's $20 million. And you need to make up another 10. You need to get within a few percentage points of the 30, almost $7 million, so probably more like $12 to $14 million. It's just hard to make up. Yeah, getting a third team involved is something that would make all of that work. So it's definitely feasible. I like the idea of him on that team. For sure, like that. Yeah,
that would
sure.
be fun.
I can see that. We're going to switch it back up, though, as promised. We just had to break the news. That stuff was crazy. Yeah. Just out of nowhere. We hadn't heard from – exactly. Yeah, very true. We haven't heard it from the Harden front, well, besides the fact that, you know, we're not trading you, report to camp, or the Dame front in a long time, and then all of a sudden, boom, just drops it. So
had to cover it. Training camp and media days next week for a lot of these teams, so better get some NBA things figured out soon.
It's on its way, my friend. I can't wait.
Yeah, so excited.
Back to Thursday Night Football, as promised. It was a matchup in the NFC North. Detroit visiting Lambeau on this Thursday night. Not quite frigid. I don't think it's that cold up there yet. It's only September. So it wasn't any snow on Lambeau, but it did rain touchdowns for the Lions. Kind of handed it to him, bro. 34-20
Yeah.
Did you see any of the game?
Saw just the second half when I came home from work. But like you were talking about, man, it was just David Montgomery just did work today. He just ran the ball like crazy. And it's crazy. You talked about it's not that cold yet in December or anything. Like it's snowing back there where everyone's running all game. But today, 32 carries, 121 yards, 3 touchdowns. He ran it all over the Packers today and just made it look effortless.
Easy.
Really.
It was weird, man. I'm a little personally irritated by how well he's doing. Nothing against him personally, but I had heard everybody say, oh, look out for Gibbs. Oh, Gibbs is looking great. Oh, Dark Horse Fantasy back in Gibbs. Oh, Gibbs is ready for a breakout rookie. Yeah, freaking right. Gibbs doesn't even get the damn ball, dude. It's only David. Again, happy for you, David, personally, but a little bit irritated. There's so much chatter because I'm pretty sure I took him with one of my top 5 picks.
Oh,
and
no.
It's really paying out to be, I think the most points he's ever got in a game is 9. And he's averaging about 7.
Hey,
so
wait,
it's a little irritating.
Did you play him this week? Because we're playing each other. Did you play him? Or no?
I did not play him. Because I was so irritated because I did play him week 1, and I did play him week 2, and I did play him week 3, and he didn't eclipse. He didn't get to double digits one time. So I said, you know what? Enough of you, sir. Back to the bench.
Back to the bench. That's right. Which, speaking back to the
random
bench, if we were doing back to the bench today, my new pick for that today is Jared Goff. He did not look good today. 19-28, 210, a touchdown, interception. Just not good overall, I don't think. And thankfully, the Lions were able to run the ball and get the win. And another quarterback, Love, did not look good either. He had 2 picks today. And we talked about last week, he looked so good in that comeback against New Orleans.
Yeah.
Down 17-0, but today he definitely showed that he's a young quarterback and, you know, still doesn't have the experience because that line defense made him kind of look like he was lost a little bit at times tonight.
They had, when I was listening, they had, I think, 5 sacks in the third. I don't know if they're 4 sacks, maybe. I don't know if they finished with anything more. I'm sure they did. But Aiden Hutchinson was just everywhere, bro. You couldn't stop that guy to save anything. So they were reading everything. It was funny. I forgot who was calling the game. But I think it was Al Michaels and somebody else. Kirk Herbstreit. Yeah, so Kirk Herbstreit says to the camera, he's like, basically, this is what I see happening in this game. And it's one of the plays where it's an option, an option run. And Jordan Love has the ball, and he's got nowhere, dude. All of the Lions players are basically right in front of him. And he, at the last second, pitches it to Aaron Jones. And as he pitches it, he gets freaking knocked on his ass. His feet in the air and everything. Boom. And then right as Aaron Jones catches it, he, boom, gets freaking cut and does a freaking flip, dude. Literally lands, does a flip.
No.
And he's like, that's what you think. That's exactly what this game is happening right now. That's how you could summarize what the Packers game is. And that's about right. I watched about as much as you did. I think I started late in the second quarter. But I was cooking and stuff, so I didn't necessarily, like, watch it.
Yeah.
But, yeah, it was not good. I'm surprised they even put up the 20 points. I don't know what I was thinking in picking them, but that didn't work out quite well.
Yeah, not at all. And you talk about Jordan Love not having a good game and struggling on the offense, but, he did not throw the ball well at all. But you were talking about earlier some stat that he, like, doesn't even throw catchable balls most of the time.
Yes, true. I saw something. I forgot who had posted it. Apologies. I need to give credit for these things. But there was a stat that I saw on X that said 31.5% of Jordan Love's throws this season have been categorized as uncatchable, which, of course, leads the NFL.
That's not
so basically, as one in every 3 times that he throws the ball, nobody will be able to catch it.
Wow. That's not good.
That's not the good formula for a quarterback.
His interception numbers at the end of a full season as a starting quarterback are going to be crazy. Okay, look at this. I'm throwing this out this now and see if I'm right.
Okay.
At the end of the season, Jordan Love is going to have more interceptions than C.J. Stroud will for the Texans.
Yes, C.J. Stroud has 0 right now.
Yeah, and he's a rookie. And Jordan Love is not necessarily a rookie, but he's been sitting on the bench a long time and learning. But I think he's going to throw
more interceptions. He's played in NFL games before.
Yes. He's going to throw more interceptions than C.J. Stroud at the end of the year. I'm calling it right now.
100%. I agree with you. I don't know if there's like a way you could do that on FanDuel where you just specify that thing. But, yeah, I would put money on it for sure. There's a couple. Do it. There's a couple other NFL games that we want to touch on. There's a lot of good ones upcoming this weekend. I think every week is good. I say that because I know, right? NFL's so fun, bro. That's all. I guess that's the only reason why I say that.
Yeah, but we got some big division battles. That's why it's, I think, a little more interesting this weekend.
Yeah, couldn't agree more. Not couldn't agree. Couldn't agree. So the first one that we're going to talk about is the Ravens visiting Cleveland. Ooh, Lamar going to Ohio to take on Cleveland. Browns are favored by 2.5. Miles Garrett is hungry. I'm sure he's ready to eat some crow. I know the Ravens, but you know.
Yeah, I got you.
Over-under is 40.5. These guys' defense is pretty good, so I kind of see this, you know, being more of a low-scoring game. I think it's going to be under. I think it's going to be even lower than that just because I feel like the defenses are really good. I've got the Ravens coming up top. You've got the Browns coming up. What do you think of this game?
I just think the Browns' defense is really, really good. I think they're ranked second overall according to PFF, so behind the Niners, so that tells you how good they are. Third-best run defense. I think the Ravens obviously run the ball a lot, and especially with Lamar Jackson running out of the pocket a lot, or not as much as usual, I guess, or prior seasons, but he still can do it. It's in Cleveland. That's kind of the main thing I went with. If it was in Baltimore, sure. I think I would have lent more Baltimore side, but I feel like being at home and having that crowd, and I don't know, Deshaun Watson's had some up and down moments this year so far, but if that defense is as good as it is and can show up,
he doesn't have to be perfect.
Which, dude, my comeback player of the year, OBJ, is not looking good right now. He hasn't played the last couple games. So, and then the Ravens.
Played like well, or he hasn't played because of injury, or he hasn't played because they don't need him.
No, he's been out the last two games with an ankle injury, I believe. So he's not even playing. Yeah,
well, he's going to be coming back in the middle of his comeback year, bro.
It might be part of the problem is he's with Kardashian now, so that there's like that Kardashian curse.
That's the jinx, dude. Yeah, which one? Oh, I didn't even know that.
I think he's with Kim right now.
I'm not up on the news, dude. I'm not up on the news.
I only hear because he's hurt. It's the curse. But regardless, the Ravens just have not looked as good on offense as I expected going into the season. They've kind of struggled. And this is also not just a Browns defense that's really good, but it's a division rival, and you play each other every year. And it's the same coaching staff. So you're going to know each other really well. I think it's going to be a low-scoring game with you. The over-under is only 40.5, like you said. So I expect the Browns to basically like shut them down and win maybe 14-9. It's going to be like a weird low-scoring game, maybe a lot of Justin Tucker field goals for Baltimore, and that's it.
I can see that. That's pretty good. You're right, though. The Browns do have a good defense. I have the Ravens coming up top because they also have a pretty good defense. They are ranked top 4 overall. I get that you get to top, you know, you're second, but top 4 overall, second in run, and third in cover defense. So they are really just right there. And I think I know that Jerome Ford is good, and I'm thinking about playing him, but I do think that they can slow him down. It's not the same as Nick Chubb. So I agree with you. I think it's low scoring. I think it's funny they picked 14-9 because I'm just going to take 1 point off of them and give it to the Browns, but I'm going to switch it and say that the Ravens win 13-10.
Okay, yeah, we're right in the same ballpark. We, like you said, both really good defenses, so don't expect a lot of scoring down on this weekend.
Not at all. Somewhere where I do expect scoring, maybe not as much because division rival as well, and you know each other, so it's sometimes a little bit less. Moving over to New York and Buffalo. Dolphins, Tua, and that 70-point offense.
Man.
Visiting Buffalo. We're split here as well.
Yeah.
I'm taking Miami. You got the Bills.
Yeah, I think the Bills being at home again is a big part of it. I think even though it's not December cold like we talked with Green Bay and stuff earlier, but it is New York. It's not Miami heat where you have that, what did we talk about, like a 30-degree difference on your sideline?
Yes.
Of the sun during that time of day. Mm-hmm. So, you know, Buffalo will be ready to go. They played very well last week against the Commanders. I feel like they've got themselves feeling much better than they were 2 weeks ago with a big 37-3 win.
Yeah, that's big.
So, you know, obviously the Dolphins are coming off a huge high, but if you're the Bills, you're at home. You don't want to let them come in and try to do anything of what they did last week because it's going to be embarrassing. You're going to feel even worse. Oof. And if the Dolphins are 4-0 and you lose to them now and go down to 2-2, not only are you two games back, you have the tiebreaker right off the bat. You're losing it. So that second game against them later in the season becomes that much more important, which is not good.
No, because it's in Miami. Well, I'm praying the Dolphins take this one. I'm hoping they can take the division, so obviously this would be a great start to aiding in that. Dolphins are graded so high on offense, according to PFF. It's actually pretty insane. Okay, check this out. The overall rating for their offense is 93. I believe it's out of 100. So that's obviously really good. Second place, okay, is the Detroit Lions, who we just saw put up 34 points tonight in Green Bay. So, yeah, I would agree that they have a really good offense. Their overall rating, 79.9. Oh. Yes, they're 14 or 13 points back. Wow. Or the Dolphins are 13 points ahead in overall offense. Which is insane. The gap is insane. The fact that their offense is good is not crazy, but the fact that the next best one is that far back is crazy.
Yeah, that's a big gap.
Right. They have the best, eighth best overall defense, sixth best overall in coverage, so they can defend as well. Bills are also known to throw the ball. Josh Allen gets crazy. And they have the sixth best coverage team. It's not great. It's not technically top five, but it's just outside. I do think that they're going to score. Buffalo Bills have an overall defense of 11th, second on coverage, so they know how to maybe lock down. But there's a lot of weapons they got to cover. So it's a lot of ground, and they're all really fast, as we've talked about before. And Miami can run the ball well as well. They have Devon Achane. I don't remember how to say his name. And Mostert there. Well, Lightning and Thunder. I think it's going to be somewhat high scoring. I'm saying Miami, hoping Miami, 27-24.
Okay, that's not bad. I definitely expect it to be high scoring, but not obviously Miami last week high scoring, like you said. No, but I do see Buffalo taking it at home and probably winning like 31-21.
Okay, all right. We split on those. But when we move to our third game that we want to cover, it's actually the Monday night game. We both kind of agree here. We'll talk about the Seahawks visiting New York, the Giants, that is. Wouldn't necessarily seem like one of those games that might be important. But when you kind of look at the way each of them will be, each team will be, how depending on how the game plays out, the standings kind of fluctuate kind of greatly. If the Giants lose, since they're 1-2, instead of going to 2-2 with a win, they would fall all the way to 1-3, which, as we know in the NFC East, is almost not an insurmountable lead, I wouldn't say, but you're going to get left behind, and you're going to get left behind quickly. Even the Commanders are 2-1 already. So you being 1-3 is not a great start. The Seahawks, if they were to win, instead of being that mediocre 2-1 or 2-2, they would move, assuming the Niners beat the Cardinals this weekend, they would move to still only one game back, 3-1, still only one game back in the division, and they haven't played each other yet. That's pretty crazy.
That's a big one right there, dude.
Yeah, so there's kind of some implications here that make it seem like it might be a small game, but seasons lean on these types of, you know, crux positions where you get to that crossroads. And if you take this way, your season's not necessarily easier. I don't want to say that, but the climb that you're trying to make is a lot easier being this way than in this weird hole, even though it's only one game. It's a weird position.
No, absolutely. And I'm with you. The Seahawks, this is a huge game for them more so than the Giants, because if they can go to 3-1 and they haven't played in the 49ers yet and ultimately see them the first time and beat them, if they have the same record again, like we talked about earlier, you have that first tiebreaker in your corner, and then you just got to take care of business. And hopefully if you see them the second time, by then it doesn't matter that you beat them, but you have the fact that you beat them the first time. You have a blueprint of something to work with.
Yep, very true. I think we both have the Seahawks, obviously. I think the game that they gave up in LA, I wouldn't say a fluke per se, but it's somewhat fluky. Because I do think this team is actually pretty legit. Pete Carroll is no amateur. He knows obviously how to play, but coach this game of football. I mean, obviously knows how to play too. And I think he can get it done. I don't think it's lopsided though. I'm thinking the Seahawks like a 30-20.
Okay, I can see that. I'm going to go probably more like a 28-23 Seahawks. Okay. Be a little closer.
But we're both on that, obviously.
I don't know. The Giants' offense has looked so bad in the last couple of weeks. I hope they can even score that many points. We might be way off on that when it's all said and done.
Yeah, well, the Giants are not that great, so there goes my division pick.
Yeah, well, we both have a couple bad ones. It all happens, which we both have some good picks and we both have some bad picks. That's what happens when you do a lot of this, which leads us to our next segment of King of Spreads to see what our updated standings are.
Yeah, I don't really have good picks too much. I am the most mediocre at this that I could possibly think of. But let's share anyways. I was excited because I had one. I caught up one the week before because you know, I had seven again. And you had six this time. But as the YouTube audience can see, I got seven right again. Corey got nine right this time. Yeah. For those of you who aren't watching on YouTube and are listening on the podcast version, go check us out. Just search Our View from the Bench. So you got nine. I've got seven. I think that's just my number. I don't know. I don't think this is my thing. I'm not very good at this.
Good thing is this part we're not spending any money on. It's just between you and I just for fun. But, you know, the spread thing is not that easy. Fun. No, it's not for you, I guess. I'm having a better time.
Oh, yeah, you're great.
But I've done this before, actually. That's the only reason I knew this existed, that we're using this on Yahoo.
My
coworker Tim has a group that does this every year, and it's like, I don't know, at least 40 to 50 people in it every year.
Oh,
I used to do it, and I was always like in the bottom five. I was terrible at it. So
You're better than me.
So if you were in that league and I'm good, you would have been way worse than that. You'd be at the bottom with me, dude.
Well, misery loves company. I guess I'll take it. We're picking already for this week, and guess what? Wrong again.
Off to a good start, aren't we? Jeez.
I had, of course, thought, you know what? You know what it was? I had picked this about 15 minutes before the game started. We were headed to the grocery store, and I had just gotten off work, and I hadn't done this yet, and I knew I needed to get it locked before the thing, and I wasn't going to be back in time from the grocery store. So I just went, and I just did it, and I was like, Green Bay's at home. There were underdogs. That's weird. They just came back and beat the Saints. I don't know. They're good. Let's go. I'm not making excuses, but that was way wrong. They lost by a lot.
Well, I'm already off to a much better start than as you because I picked Detroit. So there we go.
As we do have our spreads, Miami. Oh, you have Miami covering because initially. Oh, you know why? Because initially, coming up in a later segment, Miami might be involved in one of our I got five on it bets. So stay tuned. Overall standings, last week again, I'm 7-9. Woo! Corey, 9-7. Previous week before that, season total, we're sitting at 21-26 for myself. 26-21 for Corey, so I'm five back, man.
Hey,
gosh, I'm bad at this.
Hey, man, it's early. We've only done 3 weeks. We got a long way to go. But the problem is a lot of the games we end up picking the same, so there's no ground to gain, which... Last week we thought we picked all the same games, but we figured out that was just a little mishap, but that's okay.
So what happened was, and actually if you're on the YouTube video, you'll see it, where I had quickly pasted. I was trying to put it together. It was super last second, and I was hurrying. Not only did I paste the wrong one, I pasted it over Corey's face. So if you notice, he probably has something like this over his face last episode. Not only is it over his face, it's the wrong one. I basically just copied my own. So when I said we had the same one, I did say we had the same one because it was the same one. It was mine. That's my bad. It's different.
It happens. It happens, man. We make mistakes.
I was rushing.
You on this as well.
I was rushing. That's my bad.
But overall, you know, it's a fun thing to do. It keeps the games entertaining. It's just basically like fantasy again, but we're not losing any money on this one, so I feel much better about it.
Agreed. I don't like to lose money. It's not that fun.
No, definitely not.
Who's somebody who did lose money is anybody who was kind of riding the primetime train, especially when they were riding it last week. I know a lot of people, and I'm not putting Colorado down. I root for Colorado like anything. There's never been something I've talked about more. I've never talked about Colorado. I talk about him every week now. It's the only thing that I can talk about. I can't stop because he's so great. But he did kind of get a hand to him. We're talking about him again this week because they are hosting a Pac-12 rival for the last time, right?
Yep.
And a top 10 college football playoff hopeful team in University of Southern California.
Yeah, should be interesting, man. This is a big game, not just for the conference, but the overall playoff standings. Colorado was in the top 25 until they, you know, didn't have a good game last week in Eugene against Oregon. So if SC can go in there and take care of business and not just win by like a field goal, they need to go in and win by like a dominant 14-20, make it look, you know, make Colorado not look very good. Because SC has beaten some not good teams, but they've also kind of struggled a lot on defense, and they can't continue to do that if they think they're going to have a chance in the college football playoff. But if you're Colorado, you got to show up, because last week you did not play well in Eugene. For all intents and purposes, they were just not there at all. They didn't show up.
No.
This is a home
game. Besides to talk crap.
Yeah, they did do that, but they need to show up and get back to what they do on offense. But I did hear a stat the other day that I think Shador has been sacked, like, if not the most in the top couple.
The most, you're right.
Okay, the most in the country. And I believe SC has the most hurries on quarterbacks in the country so far in defense. So
it's a bad combination.
If that's the formula or the combination going in, that is not a good start for Colorado. But they definitely need to be ready because – SC defense needs to prove themselves still, and if this is an opportunity to do so, this is going to be why a lot of eyes are going to be on this game, even if Colorado is not ranked at this point.
Right, because they have been ranked, and this is an opportunity to show you going on the road, so take it.
Yep.
Yeah, it's not like it's one of those home games. Right now is the start of the SC schedule. They start playing the meat of the Pac-12, and as we've talked about before, there's a lot of ranked Pac-12 teams, including obviously Oregon and Washington coming up. And the other game that we want to talk about, Utah and Oregon. But before we get to that, we have this weird question that we were thinking. Laffy, shout out to you. Thank you for it. Corey and I both think that USC will win this game and hopefully win it handily. And I don't mean that as a slight to Dion. I'm just a truly big Pac-12 fan. And I believe USC, Washington, and Oregon have the best chance of one of those three teams being in the college football playoffs. So I want those three teams to win as much as possible. Obviously, they're going to play each other. So from there, obviously, I'd have to kind of figure it out. But because of those three, that's the only reason why. I'm not necessarily rooting against him. Okay, I just want to make that clear. I actually mostly root for him. But if, for some reason, that doesn't happen, let's say Colorado does pull up the 22-point upset, and even if they win by, let's say, 3-10, doesn't even have to be by a lot, maybe 7-10. Okay. What does that mean for like the big picture of everything? Not necessarily just for Colorado, but maybe for Colorado's program, maybe for Dion, maybe specifically just this season in the rankings. What do you think that does? How does that maybe switch everything up?
I mean, it could do a lot if you think about it. I mean, this is Caleb Williams, a Heisman winning quarterback. This is Lincoln Riley, the highest scoring offense, like always, every year.
Who produces Heisman winning quarterbacks.
Exactly. So if they go into Colorado, if they went into SC and did it, that'd be even crazier. But like you said, if they were able to beat them, and not just beat them, like not make SC look good. You don't have to beat them by a lot, but if they make SC's offense look not good and just mundane and not do a whole lot, or give Caleb Williams just a big tough day, then I mean that changes a lot. Maybe Colorado can jump really back into the top 20 with a big win like this, and then knock SC down to 15 even. But like you said, if you're a Pac-12 fan like we are, we want the Pac-12 to be represented in the college football playoffs. So if it's not SC, Oregon or Washington, which Washington looks really good so far, are the only other two opportunities. So if Colorado knocks SC down, not only does it affect everything that's going on in the college football playoffs and the Pac-12 and everything, but like you said, for Colorado, that's a huge, like, kind of gives them another building block to work with and show these kids, like, look what we can do when we actually show up and pay attention to detail and not just talk and smack on the, like, I haven't heard a lot of them talking this week going into this.
Not a lot to talk about, dude. I mean, they probably know that SC means the real deal too, especially since they saw what a real deal Pac-12 is known for their offense and quarterbacks, it seems, right? So what a real Pac-12 offense looks like, which is good luck, watch out, duck, because they're coming. So, and that's exactly what SC brings to the table. Caleb Williams, like you said in a previous episode, looks like a man amongst boys on the field there, ready for the next level. There's a reason why he's one of the Heisman favorites, and definitely one of the favorites to be first overall in the draft, as long as he declares, of course.
Yeah.
But I think long-term for Dion, it's just another, like you said, notch in the belt. It's good for the program. I think they can move up in the rankings. I don't think that they'll be considered in a college football playoff. They've already gotten blown out by Oregon. So unless Oregon just has the worst rest of the season known to man, there's no reason why they would ever be above Oregon. So for that case, obviously, I don't want them to do too well because, again, I just want somebody in the Pac-12.
Yeah.
I think the legacy of Colorado only grows. The problem is, I don't know how much of it is solely attached to Dion. So while he may have brought more attention to HBCUs in general when he was at Jackson State, I don't know if he adds that same effect or will have that same effect, not that it's his fault, on Colorado, in the sense that I think he is the effect. So if he were to move on, that specialness that Colorado had is kind of going with him, in my opinion. Not that there couldn't be someone left that was on his team that made it special as well, or on his staff, but I don't know. I'm curious what it does for Colorado and what Deion does from here. Yeah. It's something crazy to think about. Again, I don't know if they could do it.
It's interesting that you say that about, like, if he were to leave, the effect would leave with him, essentially, because I think I heard the other day somewhere that if he were to stay there his entire contract that he signed with them, I think ultimately the school would probably get worth up to $1 billion that they would make in that time, because between
that was a B, you know, right? But yes, billion?
A billion. Yeah, okay. Because you have alumni donating like crazy. They'd be selling out every football game. They'd be, I mean, look at all those people that little Wayne walking them on the field. The Rock is on the sideline. That's
Terrell Owens, dude.
It's out of control. So if it's just, if it's that for 4 years or 5 years,
we're in KFC contract, commercials,
right? And then you're going to sell merchandise like crazy of Colorado Buffalo stuff. If you get dude, other sponsorships just put a involved.
Picture Deion with his sunglasses, just his head right on the sweater. I'm buying 10.
Sell those sunglasses in the student store with the school Done. Logo on the side. Like, you know, they're just going to make a boatload of money off it. But like you said, it's a matter of if he's there the whole time or if someone else decides, well, maybe he actually is. Because I know there's been a lot of talk of like, oh, it's HBCU. It's not the same. Go to a big five conference team. Well, he's in the big five now conference, and he's looking like he knows what he's doing still. So if that's the case, maybe somebody's going to snatch him up out of Colorado before his contract even ends. Like, his two sons could possibly be leaving to the NFL, if not this year. I think the next 2 years. So what if they leave and he decides he doesn't want to coach anymore because they're not there?
True. Yeah. I don't know how dedicated he really is to coaching. I don't know how much. I mean, I know he has a lot of other things that he could possibly do with his time. He's a very charismatic man. So
absolutely.
I know that he could do anything he wants. So moving on to the other piece of the Pac-12 that we want to talk about. Number 10, Utah, going to number 19, Oregon State. It's weird to see Oregon State this high. I haven't seen them this high in a while. Utah Utes have been up here, but Oregon State hasn't. Kind of, yeah, like I said, loving to see Pac-12 up here, man.
Absolutely, but they're just going to beat up on each other and knock someone else down. But it's weird. I feel like Utah, they didn't win. I think they won, 14-7 over UCLA last week, and they didn't look that great. And UCLA has been okay, so I don't know what to expect of this game, but it's in Corvallis, so Oregon State's been known to have some upsets at their home fields.
Yeah, and I think this is going to be one of those weeks. And wait, do you mean upset as in the lower seed beating the higher seed, or upset as in losing at home?
No, upset as in Oregon State's going to beat Utah.
Ah, no, disagree. Utah's going to Oregon State and they're taking it. I don't think it'll be a lot. I think it's like a 10-point game, but I think Utah takes it. And I think they progress. And I kind of think so because I kind of want that. Maybe another Pac-12 team that's in the top 10.
Yeah, true.
Climbing higher. So
I just feel like
don't care though, to be honest with you.
There's been always some weird games that SC's played in Corvallis where it's super foggy and you can't see anything when you kick, and so you just never know what's going to happen up there. And like I said, Utah only won 14-7 over UCLA. So
yeah,
Oregon State's ranked higher than they are. So maybe Oregon State can get the win. And again, it's a home field game for them.
True, the fog. Another top 25 matchup involves Notre Dame again. I know we talked about them playing Ohio State last week, and we talked about them in the last episode losing that game with 10 men on the field on the last second. So playing again, though, number 17. They are 11th, and they are going to ranked 17 Duke.
Yeah.
They're bouncing back from the awkward loss to Ohio State at home.
Well, they better. That's a weird thing that you even said, number 17 Duke, and we're not talking about basketball.
Basketball, like, dude, right?
What season are we talking about right now?
So but, true.
They have to win this game. They lost to Ohio State. They're not in a conference like everybody else, so they don't get a conference title game at the end to make up for that loss, in a sense. Mm-hmm. But if you lose to Ohio State only at the end of the year, and Ohio State is one of the four in the college football playoff, that helps your case much. I mean, they only lost by one score at the end of the game, so it's not like they got beat bad. But if you go to Duke and you lose at Duke, I mean, College Game Day is going there for this weekend's game for the first time ever. Again, this is college football we're talking about with Duke, not basketball.
Yeah, not basketball. So not Krzyzewski.
Yeah, so it's just weird to me that if Notre Dame goes there and loses to a number 17 and they drop below, there's no way they're making the college football playoff.
Because no, 100%. I think it's going to be hard to now, to be honest.
I think it's going to be hard for them to do it anyway, even if they win this game, unless they kill them and then they
slaughter
going down the field. And I mean, they're going to play SC. So if SC is still ranked and they beat them, maybe that helps. But yeah, if you lose to Duke that is not going to help your case for an for a college football playoff run.
Yeah, couldn't agree more. I'm sure this game is on NBC, Notre Dame Broadcasting Channel, right?
Yep.
I think that's what the NBC stands for.
I mean, it makes sense more than anything else.
While we're still a few days away, we have this weekend to play it out. Major League Baseball is about to wrap up. And with those wrap-ups are some division wrap-ups, actually. There's a couple teams that have already clinched that we talked about previously. Obviously, we talked about the Dodgers, and we talked about the Braves. We talked about how a couple teams in the AL East had secured playoff positions. But we have a little bit more clear picture now that we've progressed through this week. You want to start running them down for me, my friend?
Yeah, so the latest that we got since the last time, I think when we recorded on Tuesday, Milwaukee had clinched that night as well for the division in the Central. Minnesota's already clinched the Central. So we're basically just waiting for the AL West to be clinched at this point. And then it's just a matter of which wildcard spots are going to all filter out to where they need to be. But the big story today, at least, is Baltimore Orioles get their 100th win. They clinch the AL East, which is going to be the best record, and the AL. So unless they play the Dodgers or the Braves in the World Series, they're going to have home field against everybody else they face. So
it's
a big thing for them. That's impressive. It's their first crown since 2014, which we talked about. That was probably when Adam Jones and Machado and all them were back in Baltimore at that time. So it's just now the Rays are in the top wild card spot. So there's at least two AL East teams in there. Toronto's still battling and has that second wild card. So it ultimately could be three AL East teams in the playoffs. And the two that don't make it are the Yankees and Red Sox, which just seems weird to say out loud.
The most historic teams, not only in the AL East specifically, but pretty much all of baseball.
Yeah.
Besides, obviously, maybe the Dodgers. And then, like we had talked about the other day, that it was also weird that they're missing the playoffs, the Cardinals.
Yep, exactly.
First time in, what, 20-something years plus that those three teams?
I think longer. I think it was like 1983. It's like longer than we've been alive.
Wow. And now we're old. So that's pretty crazy. but it's pretty cool. The Braves clinched best record in National League. They are already at 103. I think Baltimore kind of has a chance to only have to fear the Braves for home field. They're two games up so far on the Dodgers, unless the Dodgers won tonight, because I think that – no, that's three teams. That's three games. No, yeah, unless the Dodgers won tonight, because then they would be only one game back. But I think they have a chance. And they definitely, like you said, locked up the top spot.
Yeah.
I think it's obviously just between Houston and Seattle. Yankees are out, even though we have them here. We just want to show that they're that far down because not really big fans. So.
Yeah, and that's the crazy thing, too, is you could end up with two AL West teams because you have Houston and Seattle battling for that last wild card, and Texas is still the division leader, but that's not even clinched. They could still ultimately drop down to a wild card, and Houston or Seattle.
One of those guys jump on.
Win the division. I love this last weekend. It's going to be so much fun and so entertaining, but – and Seattle's going to Texas, so it's not like they're going – they're all playing ultimate teams. They're playing each other. So the division could be decided basically tomorrow night between that game.
The Astros are coming to Arizona, though.
Oh.
And we're only a game and a half up on Miami as of this start of the show. So we need to kind of help, I guess, the Rangers and the Mariners by basically helping ourselves.
Yeah, so what we want is what we ultimately want is just to win all three games. Just take care of business and beat Houston, the defending champs, and feel good going into the playoffs as a wild card.
Yes.
The only problem is if they do hold the wild card spot they're in, we have to go to Philly, who won the NL last year. So that's weird. We would have to face the two teams that were in the World Series last year if it ends up that way at the end of the season and starting the
That's so true. How crazy. Well, hey, that's a good test, maybe. Yeah.
Yeah. Absolutely.
I mean, if we can get out of Philly, not out of the city, but you know what I mean, out of the series, that's a pretty big. I mean, I know they're a wild card spot, and there's definitely the Braves and the Dodgers lurking, but still.
But hey, anything can happen in baseball. Crazy. Like, the other thing, too, like when we talked about baseball back in the early part of this, when we started doing the podcast, I thought that Texas was going to win the AL. I went on about Bochy and how they have, but now with Scherzer out and DeGrom out, like, I don't know if they're going to have enough pitching when it all comes down to it. So I'm excited to see how this all ends up. But man, would it be fun to see Seattle somehow sneak in there? I think that's just.
Yes, Seattle's that's what I want.
Seattle's such a great sports city that it would be cool for them to get in because their fans are, I mean, just watching them play Houston Texas the other night, it was just like, it was awesome. It was a loud crowd. They were totally into it. It was fun to watch. I just October baseball, man. I can't wait.
And I want to see Julio Rodriguez play.
Oh, he's
so right. Good. That's his name.
Yep, Julio Rodriguez, yeah. Teoscar Hernandez. Like, they got some really good talent up in Seattle. Jerry DePoto has done a great job rebuilding that franchise.
Good for them. Good for them. Can't do anything here with the Angels, but hey, you know.
That's because Art Moreno won't get out of the way, but that's a whole other problem.
Sometimes we can't get out of our own way. And even though it's our favorite segment, we haven't been hitting very much lately, my friend.
No.
Time for five, man. I got five on it.
I got five on it.
Gosh, bro, we can't get this right, dude.
You know, we're trying. We're trying to win money. You know, we're throwing five on it, but we're not getting anything back. But we're trying. We're trying really hard. That's all I know.
I'm so annoyed, man. We started off good on Thursday with the Niners obviously covering a 10.5-point spread, which is a pretty big spread, and they covered it handily. We were like, cool, we'll take that one. That's great. And then that was the only one of three that we got right out of the five. We blew the Cowboys. Okay, but tell me who saw the Cowboys not only losing, but losing by that much in Arizona. Well, it wasn't us, so
whatever. Definitely not. But like we talked about earlier this week when we did our episode on Tuesday, if you haven't heard it, go back and search on Apple and Spotify or YouTube, our view from the bench. But if you look at it, like, we didn't know we didn't think about the coach that the Cardinals hired this year was the coordinator for the Eagles last year and knows the Cowboys really well. So maybe we shouldn't have thought they would have won, but maybe we also should have thought about covering the spread.
Yeah, we could have at least taken Arizona plus 12, right? Like that, I guess we could have done that. Yeah, that's true. That's true. Yeah.
But it wouldn't have mattered because we didn't get all five anyway, so it doesn't matter.
No. Oh, well. We moved on. Philly did cover in Tampa, so that was good. The other one that didn't, though, was freaking Jacksonville. Dude. They just lost to the Chiefs. And I was like, all right, cool. Well, they have a division rival who has a rookie quarterback coming to town.
Yep, exactly.
They should be able to cover. 8.5 isn't crazy. I feel like a 10-point game is doable for them. That's not a blowout because Texans aren't terrible. C.J. Stroud actually hasn't thrown a pick all year like we talked about. So that seemed like a no. And I have their freaking defense, 34 points.
Oh.
No. That was good. That was a great pickup. I'm glad I did that.
Oof. Yeah, that hurt you. I'm sorry. Yeah, the Jags just have not looked good the last 2 weeks. I know the first one was against Kansas City, but their defense has been okay. But, man, the Jaguars looked terrible against Houston. I don't know what happened there.
Me either. I am happy, though, speaking of the Jaguars. I was looking at my fantasy team earlier because I was watching the game, and I saw freaking Sam Laporta freaking going off, and I was like, son of a bitch, this is who Corey has. Please just don't get a touchdown. Just don't, whatever you do, just don't get a touchdown because this kid's good. And I was just like, and I was complaining to my wife. I was like, my freaking stupid tight end. He's not, I think he's good. I think Njoku's good, but I don't feel like he gets the run that he can in that offense. So I was just like irritated. He's getting like 3, 4, 5 points, and I was just like, oh, this is so dumb. I don't understand what's going on. I was just like, whatever. But there's no even good at tight ends left. Watch, look. So I go to my stupid app, and I'm looking, I'm scrolling, and all of a sudden I get to the players, and I look at tight ends, and Evan Ingram from the Jacksonville Jaguars is available. I was like, Evan Ingram, why is he available? Isn't he the starting one? That's a pretty good offer. I mean, he's projected for like almost 9 points. Okay, add, drop this guy, boom, down. Okay, wait, who the heck had him? Scroll over. I was like, oh, Corey dropped him. So thank you very much. I'm starting him against you this week. We'll see how that goes.
Yeah, no problem. Like, yeah, I just, you know, I was driving into work and I heard them talking about on the radio how he had such a good game last week and everyone was talking he might be the best tight end out of the draft and this and that. And then, you know, Jared Goff, when he finds a tight end that he can connect with, he tends to use them a lot. And I figured that's like his best way of getting the check down stuff instead of throwing down the field all year in Detroit. So, and you know, I don't need two tight ends on a roster. We don't play double tight ends, and very rarely would I play a tight end at a flex unless it was like Kittle and I had Kelsey on the team
at the
same time. So I figured, I'll let him go. But it's funny that you pick him up, and then, of course, the first game you pick him up, it's me and you against each other.
Playing you.
Hopefully he gets 7 points like Sam Laporta did tonight for me, and they cancel each other out.
No, more. 8. No, hopefully he gets more. But we'll see. We'll see. The last one that we did pick was the Dolphins. They barely covered, bro. The 6.5-point spread. It was like this close of a game. They snuck it out at the last second. Oh, Denver put up a huge fight. So that one was I was super nervous about because the way the game looked, it was just back and forth and back and forth. 6.5 though. Whew, barely back covered. Forth, luckily, yeah, it was a 50-point game. Back yeah, and back and forth, up and down the field. Down. Yeah, that's what I meant. Yeah, they covered the spread 9 times. That's what I meant. Yeah.
Oh, God. So
what
bad.
A game, dude.
Oh, terrible.
But, yeah, we got 3 out of 5. Not necessarily what the goal is, but we are trying.
This week we're going to do it, man. This is the week.
We have more. We mixed it this time. Before we were doing money lines. This week we did spreads. Now we're kind of mixing it up a little bit.
Yep, we're going to do a little bit of whatever we want.
Exactly. This is what we got for this week's 5 on it. Again, our $10 bet, $5 each. We win us $168. We got the Dolphins back on the slate. We got them covering the +3. Not necessarily winning the game, but maybe losing by a field goal, less, or winning. I think it's a decent bet until I saw that stat. The stat that said for teams that score 60 or more points in the next week, they are 1-6 straight up and 0-7 against the spread since 1960.
Yeah, it's not looking good for us. I wish I would have known that 2 days ago.
Dang it.
Not Wednesday. Dang after we placed the bet on Tuesday.
bro. We can't catch a break. We're taking the Eagles, though, at home as well to cover at 8. We feel that they were nice to us last week, so we're going to ask them to be nice to us again. They're also at home this time as opposed to on the road in Tampa. Commanders got shown what they're a little bit about last week by Buffalo in Washington. So I don't know if it's going to be a 37-3. The division rivals, I believe it's going to be a lot closer. But I could see, again, a 10-point game. That's what I said about the last division game. But we'll see. The last one on my side we got. The Cowboys covering -7, hosting New England. Look, they just got freaking hosed. I know it was a 12-point game, but that's double digits by a team they were supposed to beat by that same spread. They're going to be irritated as heck.
Oh, yeah.
And that defense is going to be, like, just hyped. I have a feeling Mac Jones is going to have a terrible day. The only problem about this game is that we'll see how well Dak Prescott does against Bill's defense. Bill Belichick, not the Bills. Other than that, I have a feeling the Cowboys will be able to cover the touchdown.
Yeah, I don't have any issue with that. I feel like the Patriots have no offense. Their defense is good, but their offense is so who knows what's going on that the Cowboy defense will wake up after last week's debacle in Arizona. I don't think they're going to let that happen again. I think last week, too, they also might have had a little bit of a hangover, the Trayvon Diggs injury, and not knowing how to go into that game plan without him because you planned all week with him before the injury. So I think they'll have a bounce back on that side. Yeah, it's very strange.
I hate practice injuries, man. I mean, I hate injuries in general, but geez.
Yeah, but the non-contact practice ones are the worst because there's nothing even going on at that
point. Like Kelsey before week one, just like running around, oh, hyperextended knee. Like, oh, geez, bro.
Yeah, it sucks. It's the worst. So, but those are the three games we picked on the spread. The other two we did just the winner as part of the parlay. So we took the Seahawks to win over the Giants, which we both talked about earlier when we went over that game since it's the Monday Night Football game. Hopefully by the time we go into Monday Night Football, we still are alive on this parlay and we can then on Monday's episode tell you we won some money. The second game we went with is the Chiefs and Jets. We went ahead and picked the Chiefs. The Jets, their offense is so bad. I know Zach Wilson's been in the news with Joe Namath bagging on him, and now Wilson's saying they're going to use that as motivation. But I'm sorry, man. I don't trust you to do anything really good against the defending champs. Not that they have the greatest defense, but, you know, Chris Jones and them are not going to just let them do whatever they want because they can't do anything anyway. So we see the Chiefs go ahead and taking care of the Jets.
The offensive line is pretty bad. And not Chandler Jones. What's his name? Chris Jones?
Yep.
Yeah, Chris Jones will have not a field day per se, but he should fare well in this game.
Yeah, absolutely.
I think the last time the Jets were good was Joe Namath. So as much as Zach Wilson wants to say that he doesn't care, we're gonna use his motivation. Last time you were good, bro, was with Joe Namath. So let's chill and just go out and play the game and try your best. And just can you just get it to Garrett Wilson? Can you just throw it to him? He's probably going to do something with it, okay?
If I'm Garrett Wilson, I'm going to him every time. Every time out, I'm going to him. Hey, throw me the ball. Throw me the ball because it worked the last three times. Throw me the ball.
Since Joe Namath was the last one to really do something in New York, and it's quite historical, we're going to keep it that way for the last segment of the show. Let's move it on to This Week in Sports History.
This week in sports history.
This week in sports history, we got two. We've got some football, but we got some college football, and we got some professional football. We're going to take it old school first. We're going to start with September 24th, 1994. Washington, UW, ends Miami's, the U, NCAA record home winning streak at 58. 58 straight home wins in Division One with 38-20 victory against the Hurricanes at the Orange Bowl, believe it or not, so on national television. Long time ago, we were six, but you remember the game, right?
Yeah, absolutely. I remember the game. It's one of my favorites.
It's the best game there was that day, so for sure it was good. The other one we got is in professional football. September 29, 2002. Seattle Sean Alexander. He had a gap. That's the only reason I remember him, but he was really good. Seattle Sean Alexander scores an NFL record 5 touchdowns. Hold on. In the first half of a 48-23 rout of the Minnesota Vikings. He finishes with only 139 yards, but 92 receiving, so over 200 total yards. And he just finished one touchdown short of the league record 6. So he just stopped. He got all 5, and that was pretty much it. They pretty much kind of just stopped right there. Wow. 5 and 1/2, bro.
Yeah, I was going to say, you said 5 touchdowns. I thought you were going to say in a game. I'm like, that's a lot. But you said in 1/2. I'm like, oh, my Lord. That's insane. But you're right. Sean Alexander had a stretch there where he was the best back, I think, for maybe 2 or 3 years. And Seattle was just – they were in every game. He was running all over.
Went to the Super Bowl.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean,
lost to the Steelers.
Yeah, but I remember Sean Alexander was on the cover of Madden, I believe, too, because of the run that he had there for a couple years.
Yes, he was. I remember that because that was Ben Roethlisberger. I believe he was either rookie or second year, so he was like one of the youngest people to win. But, you know, that defense was nasty, bro.
I think it was Roethlisberger's rookie year, and it was Jerome Bettis' last year. That was when he retired. They won in Detroit, which is where he was born and raised.
What a perfect ending to his career.
Call it a day, get your first ring, and you're in your hometown. Call it a day.
That's the ending of the podcast. At least for this episode, at least. Number 21, my friend.
Heck yeah. And remember...
back into the next gap.
Yeah. And if you want to go back and listen to our episodes, remember you can find us on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, and YouTube by searching Our View from the Bench.
Also, don't forget to follow us on Twitter and Instagram at OurViewFTB. How's the rest of your week/weekend looking? I know today's Thursday, so we got Friday and then the weekend coming up. Anything fun?
Part of the reason we're doing our Thursday recording instead of our normal Friday, Brenna and I are celebrating 3 years tomorrow, so we're going to go out to dinner tomorrow night and just chillax.
Nice. Congratulations.
Thank you, sir. And then Saturday, I'm actually working the Burt Kreischer comedy show at Honda Center, so that's going to be fun.
Oh, sick. Dude, that guy's hilarious, bro.
Yes. I told my boss as soon as I saw on the schedule, I was like, I don't have to settle the event, but let me work it. Like, I love comedy shows. I can listen to it in the hallway and hear all his jokes. And they already showed us the merch, and there's some stuff that says a machine on it. We made a jersey for him with the machine on the back. So hopefully he'll come out on the stage with it or show it at some point, which they usually
do. That's cool.
But yeah, so I'm just going to be working mostly, but yeah, celebrating tomorrow night and then working Saturday night for Burt Kreischer. What about you, man?
I don't have too much planned. I think I might go to a car show on Saturday with the team, just kind of hang out. It's been a while since I've been out there, so that'll be cool. And then, of course, football on Sunday.
Yeah.
So actually, Rocky and I almost decided to try to get to the Raiders-Chargers game this Sunday, but that would just mean she has to call out of work. And tickets were kind of expensive and stuff like that. So we just
Raider fans are gonna take over. You know, I just realized I'm not working on Sunday, so I actually get to watch football like most all day.
And I'm gonna text you back and forth like, "Dang, you forgetting that freaking stupid touchdown?" And then you're gonna text me, "I can't believe he freaking caught that."
You know what? No, like,
back and forth.
You know what's gonna happen is I'm gonna go to work tomorrow, and somebody's gonna say, "Oh, we're doing an event or this thing on Sunday," and I'm like, "Oh, okay, I'm coming in on Sunday, I guess."
I guess I'm working Sunday.
Hey, this is that time of year, like we talked about. My schedule fluctuates during the hockey season with all the stuff, so we might have our different days a week, but we will continue to do our 2 days as best as we can just so we can make sure we keep doing all our different segments and keep you guys up on our, you know, King of Spread standings. And hopefully when we hit
all
a parlay
the other sports
on a
stuff.
5 on it, we got to hit a parlay.
Yes.
Got to hit a parlay.
That's what I want the most, bro. I want this I Got 5 on to come with check, 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 check.
Yes, and then it'll pay for the rest of the whole rest of the season.
Especially all the stuff that we already lost.
I know. Damn it.
It's all right though, man. It's all right. It's all fun. So that's what's cool.
Heck yeah.
Thank you all for checking in and seeing things from our view from the bench. I'm Brendan.
And I'm Corey. Like we always say, enjoy the sports until we talk again.
Peace. We'll be right back.